Hi, everyone. My name is Laura Hunot. Thank you for joining me on Rock On. Rock On is based on Jesus' words in Matthew 7:24, where he says, those that hear the word of God and apply it to their life are like those who built their house on the rock. And that rock is Jesus Christ. I'm really excited today to have in the studio Josh Boyer. Josh is here to share his testimony of his life, how he came to a personal relationship with Christ and how Christ has worked in his life and changed him. And, I'm really excited for you to be here today. Thanks, Josh.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah. Josh, are you, tell us about your upbringing. You're from Waterloo, Illinois?
Yeah. From Waterloo, Illinois. Small town, about 20 minutes from downtown, and, born and raised there. Great family town, but it's a town that is, there's a huge, drug problem in that town. Almost, kind of seems like out of proportion for the size of town it is. I mean, it just seems to be a hub in the little farm community where drugs are just prevalent.
And you mean for like younger generation?
Yeah. I mean, it was in high school, I think is probably the worst. I mean, there's you know, heroin and all these other kinds of different, stuff that's prevalent. But when I was growing up, it wasn't something as strong as heroin, but, it was definitely, marijuana and harder substances like that, that were used on pretty daily basis by a lot of the good population of the school.
So basically, as a young person, you gravitated into drugs.
I did. Yeah. I had a loving family, a good home, and by all intents and purposes, we would call ourselves a Christian family. But mostly because we weren't anything else. You know, it wasn't that we just weren't Muslim or anything else. We were just Christians because, you know, we would go to church, you know, on Easter and
see
on Christmas.
Any Christian.
And, yeah,
see any,
that's right.
Christmas and Easter, right. You go to church.
Christer.
Right. Yeah.
So we would go a little more frequently than that. And I was exposed, to, you know, Sunday school and things like that. And I had a pretty decent, upbringing, but as I got in junior high, I kind of, just gravitated towards, people that I would fit in with. And, unfortunately that happened to be, we call them the stoner crowd. Mm-hmm. And, that's where I got my acceptance in school. I wasn't nearly as athletic as I am today. So I would, that's a total joke. But because I didn't fit in with a lot of those popular kids, I would, I just gravitated towards that, that stoner crowd, and they were accepted to anybody.
Right.
Because they just wanted, you know, the party.
Right. And to hang out.
Right. To hang out, and they didn't care what you look like or anything like that. So that was my circle.
Right.
And started off just kind of smoking, got into cigarettes when I was probably 11 or 12. Probably more so. It got heavier. I mean, you know, by the time I was 16, I was probably smoking 2 packs a day. And then I started smoking marijuana, which led to harder drugs. A lot of people don't think that's a gateway, but it really is.
Mm-hmm.
And, started doing cocaine and, crystal meth and just a variety of hallucinogenics. And, it was pretty rough.
Yeah. So, you're experiencing drugs, which is not uncommon for a lot of kids. I mean, especially as time goes on, it's more progressively known. And now at home, were you, you're obviously coming home high and experiencing things. I know you mentioned to me that you're the youngest. You have, two sisters.
I do. Yep.
And that you kind of were a bit spoiled, not a whole lot of discipline or structure in your life and kind of, weren't corrected or what have you, if you did get in trouble for things or no heavy penalty. So it was kind of easy to gravitate into those things and do those things because there wasn't a lot of resistance at home.
Correct.
Or, you know, to observe what you were doing. And so this is the crowd you're gravitating to and the things that you were experiencing. And as you said, you were progressing into using different kind of drugs. Now, did that become, were you able to function in school? Did you wind up graduating?
Yeah. I mean, when I mean, and you're right. I was brought up, with those two sisters and I was the youngest of, and I was the boy. And so, I really craved that discipline that I really never got. Mm-hmm. And I, looking back, I can see God's hand. He was my main disciplinarian, growing up. But that's another story. I did in high school, it just got, it got pretty bad, and I started having troubles in school with grades. And, I got to the point where I'd kind of made a name for myself. So I was in trouble even when I didn't do anything wrong. And, I'd kind of created this perfect storm for myself where I couldn't succeed. Mm-hmm. It was my own choices, but I just kind of, I'd also been labeled, you know, they kind of expected me to always be in trouble. And I was, it was like a self-fulfilling prophecy in some ways. So, I struggled with school and ended up having to leave Waterloo Public School and go to a different school for, it was Beck Vocational, which is a school kind of, for students. A lot of them, it's their last option
to graduate and to be able to get through high school. Right.
Right.
Yeah. And, now that was probably another opportunity to come together with other kids that are like you and
yeah.
expand your scope of opportunity for.
That was the unfortunate thing about it.
Yeah.
Is that there was all these students now were from all these different towns and mm-hmm. we had the one thing in common that we were all in trouble. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, it was our last hope, but it was also, an opportunity, like you said, for us to
network,
get connections. Right. So, yeah. So the party scene and the drugs just, kind of expanded from there. All this time as I'm growing up, my friends are dying left and right. I've been to so many funerals that I can't even count them. At least three friends would die every year, sometimes more. And, but it was, I mean, it was just, it's expected, you know, mm-hmm. there just wouldn't be somebody else in our circle that wasn't there. Mm-hmm. The next, you know, you just never knew.
Were girlfriends prevalent in your life?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I had a girlfriend that I, there was a girl that I was really, planning on marrying. I loved her. And, one night she actually, through a series of her, bad choices, was involved in a place she shouldn't have been. And she was in a car accident, two car accidents in one night. And, she got thrown out of the second car, rolled, and it threw her out, ejected her out of the car, and the vehicle landed on top of her and it killed her. And that really rocked my world because I've had all these friends dying around me, but this was my girl. Mm-hmm. And, that really, really shook me up from to the core.
To the point of helping you to get over the drugs and things.
Yeah. I mean, I see that God definitely used that. He did it because of that. I was able to, take a step back and look and see that, my choices, I had the similar, in fact, God actually kind of impressed on me that, the wages of sin is death. Like it says in Romans 6:23, and that this was going to happen to me if I keep going down this path I'm going. That girl always talked about sin, you know, and I never really knew what she was talking about. Her mom was a Christian and she talked about sin and how those consequences of sin, was leading her to this feeling of impending doom. She knew that something was going to happen and she kept it up and she did. And that's what happened. And I had the same feeling like it was just a matter of time.
That you were a train wreck. Yeah.
Yeah. I was just waiting to happen. Exactly.
So that helped you. And so, but you actually were able to get out from underneath the choices you were making for a season there with the drugs and it scared you straight or
it did.
What have you, the fear of God or.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm,
or the fear of death.
Sure.
It affected you so much. So that was a positive.
Yeah.
And so now, so drugs and stuff took a back seat. You were able to turn from that.
Yep.
Were you making better choices at that point? You had some opportunity with school, or what was going on from there?
Yeah, I had an opportunity to go to school, and I had an opportunity to go into college, and I kind of got away from the main drug addictions that I had, because I had kind of an addiction to cocaine for a while, and that really severed that. And so I was able to I hung out the same people, but I didn't do the drugs, and I got more into alcohol at that point.
And so that was your drug of choice.
Right.
Yeah, became, first so, season.
Yep.
Okay. Well, we're going to go to a break.
Sure.
And I want you to come right back to Rock On to hear more of Josh's story. Thank you. Welcome back to Rock On. For those of you that are just joining us, I'm here with Josh Boyer, and Josh has been sharing his testimony of how he came to a personal relationship with Christ. But Josh, you know, you had just shared your upbringing, that you grew up in Waterloo, Illinois,
yep.
And that your family did take you to church, and that even as a young person, you believed in God. You were dedicated by your family. That was kind of an up and down thing with your parents.
Yeah.
But as a teenager, you gravitated to the stoner crowd and the
right.
And not athletic, not strong in academics or anything, and that was where you found your acceptance, and you started in a progression of using drugs and partying to the point to where you even had a pretty strong cocaine habit,
mm-hmm.
weren't doing well in school, didn't have a lot of discipline at home or
right.
a lot of accountability.
Right.
The youngest of three children, you were the youngest boy and two older sisters. But, you know, you were sharing also that you had a girlfriend that you loved and at the time thought that you'd eventually marry somebody that you genuinely cared for. You, at a young age, were seeing, going to a lot of funerals and seeing the devastation at a young age of the consequences to using drinking and driving and alcohol and cocaine, just yep. drugs, yeah. And you were experiencing that, but then she actually died from a series of choices that she was making, had a Christian mother and knew she would talk about sin. And,
yeah.
and you both felt that there was this undooming, you know, consequences that were going to happen, but
absolutely.
Didn't know how to get out from underneath the train wreck. You mentioned in the break though, that you did always talk to God, you know, that through that dedication and through the experiences you did have with church, that God had always had his hand on your life.
Yeah.
I believe he allows you to go your own way. And then at a time and place, you know, when you're ready to repent, he'll grab you. But pick us up from, you know, where this person died, and it actually gave you an opportunity for sobriety, at least from the drugs.
Yeah.
But then you continued to drink. That was your primary drug of choice for a few years, and still hung out with the same friends, still kind of moving down the same path.
Right. Yeah. I started and you're right. I had this relationship. I remember as a young kid, just praying to Jesus and have him answer my prayers. And I knew that Jesus loved me. And I really did have this child relationship, with him. And I think I just, as I just got, I didn't really have the teaching of the church, you know, to keep me rooted.
Yeah.
And as I got influenced in school by drugs and by drugs specifically, it really kind of was put on the back burner, but I never considered myself. I mean, I still would call myself a Christian. You know, I thought for all intents and purposes, I was a Christian. And even as I got into I'd gotten away from the drugs and focused more on alcohol and just, drinking all the time. I mean, that became what I lived for. I would live for the party. I mean, I had a job so that I could pay for the party
yeah.
on the weekend.
That's you know? Your God. You don't
yeah.
even know it, but that really is.
But even at that time, I mean, I would be drunk and I'd just feel so just anxious, and I had anxiety horribly, and I would pray even in my drunkenness. I'd pray to God, you know, help me. And I mean, I could tell you story after story of how God's just had his hand on my life. There's no doubt. But I think he was using anxiety to make me uncomfortable in my sin, so
yeah.
that I would have to come to him. And so my parents got divorced and when I turned 18 and I'd gotten into try to go to school, my parents were paying for it. So it was just another place to party. And, my anxiety levels just got once that divorce happened, it was around the same time as Jamie, her name was Jamie Julius. And when she died. And so, I was really just wrought with anxiety and mm-hmm. depression and
magnified by your world being exploded by the divorce of your parents right. of how many years?
Lost that 32 years.
Yeah, and your childhood home, and right. so God, all these stabilities that you did have yeah. in your life were
everything
coming apart.
I knew. Right, everything that I knew, all of my right my rocks were crumbling beneath me, and so I was really in a bad place. For a few years, I was just drinking, and I felt like I was in this hole. That no matter what I did, it just got deeper and deeper, and there was no way I could get out of it. I just felt completely hopeless. Started dating this girl, and we off and on for like 3 years, we dated, and it was really rocky, and I was unfaithful to her, and it was pretty awful. But one night, we had broken up the last time, and I asked her I basically begged her to come back to me, that we could have a relationship again. And, she agreed, and I was pretty excited about that. But I still had this anxiety problem. And then what happened was I was on my way to DJ. I'd become a DJ at that point. And, I was on my way to DJ one of my shows, and I had this horrible panic attack, and I just felt like there was no way out of it. And so I just remember crying out to God and saying, God, just say, and I don't know if I heard something on the radio. I don't know why I cried out at that moment, but I mean, I cried out, and Jesus just overcame me with this sense that you've tried everything else. Just try me. You've tried everything else and try me. And the thing that blew my mind was that it wasn't that I could come back to him. I was overcome with love that he wanted me to come back to him. Like he wanted to forgive me. It wasn't like he was going to forgive me. He legitimately wanted to forgive me. And that blew my world. And I was like, yeah, you're right. That's the answer here. I mean, that's what I need to do. So, I spent the next few weeks trying to come to terms with what counting the cost meant. I went to a Bible study, and, you know, I'd prayed this prayer of repentance before, but I was never really ready to repent. You know, I'd cry. I wanted the salvation, but I didn't want it on his terms.
Right.
And so one of the things was that I was really struggling with was sex before marriage. And I just got this girl back.
Right.
And now I'm going to have to tell her that we can't have sex before marriage anymore. I'm going to lose her. And she's going to think I'm weird. And my family's going to think I'm weird if I become a full blown Christian. Like I know I need to do. My friends are all going to leave me. Mm-hmm. But I knew that Jesus had his hand on my heart, and I knew that that's where I wanted to go. So I went and I prayed, and I said, Jesus, I don't know where I'm going, but I'm going with you, and I'm trusting all the consequences to you. And it was a hard road to get there. Coming to the conclusion, the decision that I was going to tell her that, yeah, we're not going to have sex anymore. You know, I was looking in the Bible, and I was like, God, you know, show me where it says this in the Bible. And I'm finding all these passages, you know, and I'm like, okay, well, what, God, give me a sign, God. Yeah, I wanted anything else. So I remember praying for him to give me a sign on the way to work, which was like a 30-second drive at the time. And, you know, I'm living in my mom's basement working just right down the street. So it was awful. But, I said, God, give me a sign, you know, if this, let me hear something on the radio is what I prayed for. God, let me hear something on the radio on the way to work on this 30-second drive, knowing that it's going to, that'd be a miracle. So I got to work. I didn't hear anything. And then, I went out on my first, I was a delivery driver, for a company. And on my first delivery, I turned on the radio, and, there was a sermon on the radio about a rich young ruler who went to see Jesus. And the rich young ruler had all this gold and everything. And he was a rich young ruler, and he came to Jesus and said, teacher, how can I be, or good teacher, how can I enter the kingdom of heaven? And Jesus says, well, first off, why do you call me good? Only God alone is good, implying that he is God. And then he says that, you know, sell all your things and come follow me. And, you know, pick up your cross. And, this preacher went on to talk about that as some, and the rich young ruler wouldn't do it. And the preacher, started talking that sometimes it's sex before marriage is that one thing that people can't give up. And I just remember thinking, wow, that's a really weird coincidence. You know, I still didn't want to hear it. Uh-huh. So that Wednesday night at Bible study, I went to a Bible study, and it was my first time I'd ever been any place like that. You know, I always thought Christians were weird. and I didn't want to be in a church. They were church people. And so I remember going in this Bible study and talking to the pastor, and I was like, I'm struggling with this issue. I want to follow Christ. I know he's calling me definitely, but, what about the sex before marriage thing? Can we talk about that? How big a deal is that? You know? And he sat me down and said, Josh, there was a rich young ruler that went to go see Jesus. And he made the same exact comparison, and without having heard that prior sermon. And it was just, God just put all the pieces together, and he's like, yeah, that's a big deal. Purity before me, is a big deal. Is that going to be your one thing? Are you going to let this, you know, come between our relationship? And that's when I decided, okay, God, I'm all in. So I'm going all in. And that's when I prayed that night. I prayed and I said, Lord, like I said, I don't know where I'm going, but I'm going with you. And I just trust you to all these consequences. I just trust them to you, God. I'm following you with all my heart, soul, mind, strength. And I prayed that, and I remember going to sleep at night and having the best sleep I ever had in my life, because I knew that if I were to die, I'd be in heaven.
So you weren't anxious. That anxiety had had to have that kind of peace to lay down and have peace with God, because Christ died on that sin or on the cross to reconcile you to him, to give you a peace with God, because you're at war with him over the way you live your life. And he wants you to have peace, and he wants good for you.
Right.
So, but you're freaking out because you got to go home and tell your girlfriend.
Yeah. I thought for sure she'd leave me.
Yeah. Well, we're going to go to a break. So I want to encourage you. And if you do have that personal relationship with Christ, we want to thank you and ask for your support of Channel 24. We can't do this without you. And you know, Channel 24 is a gift here in Missouri and Illinois, and even goes out beyond that. So if you're able, and you too love to hear Christ lifted up in people's life and want to see people changed, we'd appreciate the support for Channel 24 and for New Life Evangelistic Center. And come back to the latter few minutes of Rock On. Welcome back to the latter few minutes of Rock On. Josh, you just left us hanging and telling us how, you know, you yielded that aspect of your life to God and trusted him for sexual integrity and purity in your life. Yeah. And you have to go home now and tell this gal who's accepted your faith, although she's not there yet, that this is an aspect of your life that's going to change. So tell us what happened.
Yeah, the weird thing is that she didn't leave me. And I was like, well, I mean, what do I do? You know, the Bible says not to be unequally yoked, but I've got this kind of grandfather clause going on here where I'm like, I'm still with her. I'm not going to date anybody else. So do I break up with her? I didn't really know what to do. And I really, really struggled with that. And I think out of 99% of the time, you should probably leave the person. But this time,
she's living with you.
Yeah. 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 And that had to change. That changed right off the bat. She moved out. But she still, you know, we still dated, and I knew I wasn't going to cave in because God made it so clear. So I thought, well, let's just see, you know, what happens. So the church began praying for her, and she would try to get me to go party with her and quit reading my Bible, and she would try to just tempt me sometimes. But I knew that what I had found when I accepted Christ, something happened. I mean, I was different. I no longer wanted to do the things that I used to want to do, the party stuff. I wanted to know Jesus, and I opened up the Bible, and it was talking to me, and I was like, this is totally different. I've read this book before, and I've looked in it, you know, it didn't make any sense. Now it's like talking specifically to me. So I was blown away by that. So this girl ended up a year and a half later, after hearing that she'd come to church a little bit here and there, and then she started coming more often. And about a year and a half later, she accepted Christ as her Lord and Savior. And she was instantly changed. I mean, it was a radical transformation. And then about a week later, my sister saw the change in her, because they both used to make fun of me, and accepted Christ too. And now my sister's sings at Hope Christian Church in Columbia, Illinois. She's one of the worship leaders. I'm one of the worship leaders there. And I'm also the brand new youth pastor. So,
That's awesome.
Yeah, it's been an awesome ride. My wife, we now have a daughter, and she's pregnant with our son. So
this girlfriend that you spoke of that came to Christ, you eventually got married.
We did. Yeah. I left that out. We got married, in about 3 years after that.
3 years after that.
We worked on our relationship with Christ and yeah. And so,
that's so awesome. And so that was roughly 7 years ago when you came to the Lord, and the process that he's been doing in your life since then. And you know, I wanted to point out what you said about the Christian life that is, to me, the most exciting thing. That's the hardest thing probably to explain to somebody that hasn't experienced it yet,
right.
Which is the thing that makes you able to be a Christian. You know, maybe you're stuck in drugs or sexual sin or wherever your life is, that when you ask Christ to come in and to be your Lord and Savior, He gives you new desires and He gives you an ability to live for Him, and He'll give you new desires and take away the old ones.
Yeah.
And that's the exciting thing, that He can enable anybody, no matter where you're at, to make you new.
Yep. And there's, the best thing is that there's nobody that's too far gone. There's nobody that's out of the reach of Jesus. I mean, His love is strong enough and big enough that, I always say that there's no tough nuts for God to crack. I mean, he knows what it takes to get everybody, and He can do it.
Yeah.
So just pray.
And, so what is your, what does it mean for you, Josh, to have that personal relationship with Christ?
He is my purpose. He's my life, and, just to please Him and to hear, well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your master's kingdom is what I long to hear.
Yeah. And you enjoy your life now that you're in Christ.
Isn't it
fun?
It is. Yeah. It's unpredictable, and God is just, He's big. I never know what's the next thing, but I've got this purpose and meaning in life now, and I wouldn't trade it for anything.
What about your anxiety? I mean, it's not a perfect life. We still struggle.
Yeah. That's right. The anxiety didn't go right away all at once, but I was on medication and I haven't been on anything in years. So yeah. There's no anxiety.
So God's peace.
Yeah.
Thanks for being here, Josh.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me, Laura.
Thank you for watching Rock On. God bless you.